Good morning to you from one of the ancient churches of Suffolk again. I was going to go and sit inside actually to give you a word this morning, but then unfortunately it's very dark and they've got one of these heat-seeking lights. So as I got started, suddenly I went into complete darkness, which of course was rather disconcerting. So I'm going to go to the car and I'll continue from there. Well, I'm back in the car again. Yes, it's got one of those lights where it switches on, it picks up your heat when you go into the church and then stays on for a couple of minutes and then goes off. So I realised that I couldn't really do anything in there. But yesterday in our Bible study, we were looking at the prophet Hosea, one of the minor prophets. I suppose we only call them minor prophets because they didn't write terribly much. But Hosea, historically, I won't go back into that really because it would take too long, but we're looking at the period, I think, coming up to the Assyrian captivity. And Hosea was speaking to his people, his rebellious nation of Israel, which of course continues to this day. And we were thinking yesterday about the relevance of Hosea and the things that he did and how can we update it? And let's just have a read of the first few verses of the book, and just to get a flavour of the context. And what I've done is, I didn't share all the notes I had yesterday on the book, but I had written some notes down, and it's just various things from certain verses which I'll share with you. But let's just read the first chapter here, or some of it. The word of the Lord that came unto Hosea, the son of Beeri, in the days of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah, and in the days of Jeroboam, the son of Joash, king of Israel. Very specific, isn't it? Again, this is what I like about these old prophets. As though you want to verify me, this was the period that I lived in. The beginning of the word of the Lord by Hosea. And the Lord said to Hosea, go take unto thee a wife of whoredoms, and children of whoredoms, for the land hath committed great whoredoms, departing from the Lord. So he went and took Gomer, the daughter of Diblaim, which conceived and bare him a son. And the Lord said unto him, call his name Jezreel, for yet a little while, and I will avenge the blood of Jezreel upon the house of Jehu, and will cause to cease the kingdom of the house of Israel. And it shall come to pass at that day that I will break the bow of Israel in the valley of Jezreel. And she conceived again and bare a daughter, and God said unto him, call her name Lo-Ruhamah, for I will no more have mercy upon the house of Israel, but I will utterly take them away. But I will have mercy on the house of Judah, and will save them by the Lord their God, and will not save them by bow, nor by sword, nor by battle, by horses, nor by horsemen. Now when she had weaned Lo-Ruhamah, she conceived and bare a son. Then said God, call his name Lo-Ammi, for ye are not my people, and I will not be your God. Yet the number of the children of Israel shall be as the land of the sea, which cannot be measured nor numbered. And it shall come to pass that in the place where it was said unto them, ye are not my people, there it shall be said unto them, ye are sons of the living God. Then shall the children of Israel, of Judah and the children of Israel be gathered together, and appoint themselves one head, and they shall come up out of the land, for great shall be the day of Jezreel. The whole of Hosea seems to be summed up in the first chapter. And it's really interesting when you look at what Hosea was called to do, marry a prostitute. And we were considering this yesterday in our Bible study. Can you imagine today somebody in the church standing up and saying, the Lord has called me to marry a whore? People, of course, would think he's either gone crazy or he's just a complete heretic or a fool or whatever. And yet, this was a man who loved his God, a man who knew his God. And he was obedient to such a degree that none of us probably could even comprehended in these days. But I thought about that as a command from God. What are we prepared to do as a command from God? How can you update a story like this? What has God told you to do, perhaps, that's outrageous? What will he tell us to do in the future that is outrageous, that will speak to our people at this time, in whatever nation you're in? We can see at the moment, can't we, that in the UK, those of us that are living here, and those of us that are looking on, we're becoming more and more of a laughing stock to the nation. We've had a prime minister that has sacked four of her chancellors in virtually 4 weeks. And we've seen confusion and devastation coming upon this land. And one can sense almost the same thing that Hosea was sensing, that there's a judgment coming, that there's a captivity coming, there's a difficulty coming. And it seems to be like a rolling stone just going on, or a snowball coming down the mountain and bringing forth an avalanche behind it. And I made some notes, as I said, on some of the verses here. And the son and the daughter that was born to Hosea, signs of his judgment on backslidden Israel. Call that person's name something completely negative. It's quite amazing, isn't it, what he said here. Call his name Jezreel, for yet a little while and I will avenge the blood of Jezreel upon the house of Jehu, and cause the kingdom of the house of Israel to cease. God had intentions. He had beautiful intentions for his people. But because of the state that they were in, he had to lay aside those intentions and bring about a judgment. It's going down here to verse 7. God is so merciful. And it's so interesting, isn't it, that what catches me in this first chapter here is that God speaks about his judgment, but at the same time, he's very quick to speak about his mercy. But, and there's that word again, but I will have mercy upon the house of Judah, and will save them by the Lord their God, and will not save them by bow or by sword or by battle or by horses or by horsemen. Those that are faithful, those, of course, of the northern kingdom that were not faithful, were carried away. But God's favor is on that people that will continue to look to him, and he will save them, not by the power of their own strength. He'll save them so that they will escape the wrath of God and be saved by his spirit, by his power. And that is the wonder of it all. We know that we're living in surrounded by judgment. Those of you that are in America, you're surrounded by judgment. You've got leaders that you can't turn to anymore. You can't have any trust in them. I was watching interviews on mainstream media, which I don't like watching, but you watch how they interview people who really don't take an awful lot of cognizance of what's going on around them. And they talk about how they want to put someone else in power that may give them a better deal. Someone else that may understand their problems and their plights of how to heat their houses or how to feed their children. And they keep looking to people. I've said this so often, I don't want to be a broken record, but they're looking to people all the time, trying to find what they can do to trust in them. But it isn't going to work. In verse 9, God says, call his name. Let's back up to verse 8. Now when she had weaned Lo Ruhamah, she conceived and bare a son. Then said God, call his name Lo Ami, for ye are not my people, and I will not be your God. This was a declaration of disowning the people for a time. A time when God had to turn his face away from them because they turned away from him. God calls us to endure in these last days. He calls us to walk with him in a state of holiness that none of us have yet achieved. What I'm saying here is that I think God is bringing us closer and closer to the edge of a precipice. And we can see how far we've come. We can see how far we've got to go. But at the same time, God wants us to have a sure footing. Can you imagine how it must have been for Hosea, living in a place that he was living in, surrounded by all these godless people, and then probably pointing fingers and laughing at him? You married a whore. What do you think you're doing by doing that? He couldn't have incurred the favor of the people. But what did he do? He probably had to speak out and say, you know why I did this? I did this for you. I did this because I wanted you to understand what kind of people you are. I've got this kind of wife. But at the same time, God called Hosea to faithfulness. He called him to stand with him in the action that he was doing. Imagine the patience that the man had to have with a woman that was, he knew she was a whore. He knew she was whoring around. He knew that she probably would go out at certain times and go and meet with other men. It's really quite interesting because a brother in our fellowship was sharing a story that had happened to him in his own life, how he'd connected with a lady and she was doing exactly those kind of things. And he continued with her for quite a while. And sometimes we do continue with situations, don't we? And God sometimes says, I will take you out of that situation, but not yet. There's a time coming. And then in verse 10, what is he saying here? And it's a complete turnaround. This is what God does. And this is what I get from this book here. He's giving them an absolute negative. I will not be your people. I will not be your God. And then it's as though God suddenly changes his mind. And he says, yet, the number of the children of Israel shall be as the sand of the sea, which cannot be measured or numbered. God looks forward. He looks ahead beyond the judgment that he's giving at the present time to something future. And we're seeing the judgment of the nations. Those of you, I don't know what nations you're in, maybe you could tell me this morning. It would be interesting in the comments if you can tell me where you're actually hailing from and what's going on perhaps in your nation in the terms of the way God is judging your nation. Maybe we can have a look at those comments at some point and discuss them in another video. This is interesting, isn't it? God always is quick to give the promise of the future here. And let's go on. Verse 11. Then shall the children of Judah and the children of Israel be gathered together. There's God's promise. You see, it hurts God so much to judge the nations. But he wants to so quickly give them the promise. I'm going to bring you together again. I have to do this judgment. It pains my heart. But I'm going to bring you together again. And I'm going to appoint one head. There's the first messianic prophecy in Hosea. I'm going to appoint a head, and he will come up out of the land, for great shall be the day of Jezreel. This head, this Messiah, this Mashiach, everything in the Old Testament that points to the future coming of Messiah, to the fulfillment in the new, and that's the wonder of it. Chapter 2, and just jumping here to verse 14 in chapter 2. Therefore, behold, it's all these buts, yets, and therefores, very important words, aren't they? Therefore, behold, I will allure her and bring her into the wilderness and speak comfortably unto her. That was God's intention, to speak comfortably to his people, but to bring them into a wilderness place. Sometimes it was important that God had to, by his mercy, bring them into a place of darkness, a place of desolation. But at the same time, God speaks to us in desolation. He speaks to us in darkness. He sometimes has to allow us to get there. And things are going to get darker and darker as we go on in this winter, as we see fuel poverty coming in. People deciding, do I heat my house or do I feed my children? People are beginning to complain. Everybody wants, in this country at the moment, everybody's on strike. Everybody wants more money. More money, of course, more inflation. And the situation just gets worse and worse. There is no answer in economics. There's only an answer in God. Jumping to verse 19. God's promise again. And I will betroth thee unto me forever. Yea, I will betroth thee unto me in righteousness and in judgment and in loving kindness and in mercies. You see, all this is a book that's mixed together with judgment, wrath, and the mercy of God. It all happens all at once. With God, there's no time. God doesn't say, well, I wonder what I'll do in the future. I wonder how I'll kind of work this thing out. He's already got it worked out. And that's the thing that we can take comfort in. And verse 19, I will betroth thee unto me in righteousness, the marriage supper of the Lamb. This is back in all those hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years ago. And as I said, God is timeless. But for us, we're about to be betrothed. We are betrothed, aren't we? We're about to be married. Married to the Lord in the coming of the rapture. The rapture time, sorry, in the coming of the Lord and the coming of the rapture. All these events, of course, God sees them and he's already seen the end of them. That's the wonder of it. Chapter 3 is quite interesting here. Then the Lord said unto me, go yet, love a woman beloved of her friend, yet an adulteress, according to the love of the Lord toward the children of Israel, who look to other gods and love flagons of wine. God looking down on the people that he'd chosen, watching them turning to sin. That must have been the hard part for a holy God. It's always the hard part for a holy God, watching them turn to sin. And of course, as Israel turned to sin, and as the temples were destroyed, they turned to a different kind of Judaism. A Judaism that wasn't pure. A Judaism run by the rabbis, as what we have today in Israel. We don't have a real Judaism. There's no temple. They can't have it. Of course, now the aspiration is to get that temple built. And for what they think is to get back to the true religion. But of course, at the moment, as we can see, it's been abandoned to that. And so it goes on. And verse 6 is key here. I think it's chapter 5, verse 6. Let me just check that. Yes, it's chapter 4, sorry. It's chapter 4, verse 6. This verse everybody knows, and I'm sure when I quote it, you will know it too. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge, because thou hast rejected knowledge. And I will also reject thee, that thou shalt be no priest to me. Seeing thou hast forgotten the law of thy God, I will also forget thy children. Destroyed for lack of knowledge. God is calling us all at this time to get informed. Please get informed about what's happening around you. Don't be destroyed by being foolish. Don't be destroyed by being empty-headed. There's a lot of people that need to gain a lot more knowledge about what's going on at the moment. We were talking yesterday, and I went to a teaching meeting last night at one of the local churches, and somebody was pointing out I didn't know the local vicar of that Anglican church, but somebody was pointing him out to me and saying to me that he's a man with two doctorates in theology, a very clever man. But when they try to speak to him of prophetic things, he doesn't understand them. He just can't get to understand what God is saying in these times. We can read the book of Hosea in its historical context and gain some knowledge about what happened at the time. But I believe that the scriptures now want to speak to us for what is happening now. And if there are men that are in pastoral leadership that don't understand the scriptures from the perspective of the prophetic picture of the future, they can't see what's happening around them. And if you can't see what's going on around you, you can't feed your people properly. And that is so important. So my people need to gain knowledge to avoid destruction. Chapter 6, verse 1. I'm skipping through this because, as I said, I can't go through the whole book. It would take me all day. So I've just picked out some pertinent bits. Come, let us return unto the Lord, for he hath torn, and he will heal us. He hath smitten, and he will bind us up. In other words, repent and return. Verse 2. After 2 days he will revive us, and then the third day he will raise us up, and we shall live in his sight. What a clear prophecy of Jesus' work on the cross. Isn't that marvelous? When you find these scriptures, and you can, if you've never read Hosea before and you come across that, you think, goodness me, oh yes, this is about Jesus. And what did he say to his disciples? On the third day, the Son of Man will be risen up. And there it is. Jesus knew the scriptures. He probably, for the 3 years that he was with his disciples, he was imbibing, getting them to imbibe the truth about himself. And he was probably reading these prophecies to them so that they could understand who he was. Chapter 8 and verse 7. Just some random pieces here. For they have sown the wind, and they shall reap the whirlwind. It hath no stalk. The bud shall yield no meal. If so it be yield, the strangers shall swallow it up. Another promise there of what happens when you're not faithful to the Lord. You reap the whirlwind. Those who sow the wind will reap the whirlwind. Whatever you reap is the result of what you've sown. Chapter 10, verse 8. The high places also of Avon, the sin of Israel, shall be destroyed. The thorn and the thistle shall come up on their altars. And they shall say to the mountains, cover us, and to the hills, fall on us. What does Jesus say in Matthew 24? Exactly the same thing. Pray that your flight will not be in winter. Isn't it? Woe to those at the time that are suckling with babies, and will call to the mountains, fall on us, and to the hills, cover us. Time of Jacob's trouble. A time when Israel again will suffer in a future time. Not so long away, I don't think. But she will suffer again. A remnant will come forth. But yet there's much suffering for Israel in the time of God's wrath. God will preserve her. He will preserve his remnant. They will come through for him. Verse 12. Sow to yourselves in righteousness. Reap in mercy. Break up your fallow ground. For it's time to seek the Lord, till he come and rain righteousness upon you. Break up your fallow ground. If you have not got that knowledge, if you're not informed about what's going on around you, if you can't see we fight not against flesh and blood, against principalities and powers, it's time for you to seek the Lord in a new way. This is the wonder of judgment in a way, isn't it? It's the wonder of what's going on at the moment in the world, because although we can see all this evil rising, this is the greatest time of all for the gospel to go out. The greatest time of all for people to reach out to the Lord and to say, I'm in despair. I can't feed my children. I can't heat my house. My husband's running away with another woman, vice versa, with a wife and a man. Who knows? People are coming under strain. They're coming under stress. Chapter 11, verse 7. And my people are bent to backsliding from me, though they called them to the Most High. None at all would exalt him. Bent to backsliding, you see. This is what's been happening. This is what's happening. This is the apostasy, the rise of the apostasies Paul speaks about in 2 Thessalonians. And as they're bent to backsliding, there comes a time when their backs are so bent to backsliding that they can't straighten up again. God calling all the time. God's voice is calling to people, but they don't hear. Verse 12. Interesting here. Ephraim compasseth me about with lies, and the house of Israel with deceit. But Judah yet ruleth with God and is faithful with the saints. Interesting here how this is the historical division between Israel and Judah. But at the same time, God is speaking to Israel and Israel. He's speaking to Jew and Jew. And of course, if you go to Israel today, there's still only a remnant of Jews that believe in Messiah. Many, many, of course, would castigate you, would persecute you if you were as a Jew. I remember going to Israel back in the 1980s and being given a command from the Lord in Ezekiel to share the gospel with Jewish people. I've spoken about this before, and it's amazing the hostility that one gets, especially as a Jew trying to share the gospel with Jews. It's quite an experience. They tend to forgive you if you're a Christian or a Gentile, but if you're a Jew trying to give the gospel to a Jew, you're up against it. God is looking for the Judas. He's looking for those that are faithful in the end times. But he has a Jewish remnant. I've spoken about this in my studies on Romans 9 to 11. If you'd like to go back in my video list, you'll find them. I did three studies, Romans 9, 10 and 11, on God's purposes and plans for the salvation of the remnant of Israel in the last days. Chapter 12, I'm just reading verses 2 to 5. Ephraim feedeth on wind, and followeth after the east wind. He daily increaseth lies and desolation, and they do make a covenant with the Assyrians, and oil is carried into Egypt. You see, making a covenant with evil. This is what people are doing in politics all the time, trying to make alliances, trying to make covenants. The Lord hath also a controversy with Judah, and will punish Jacob according to his ways, and according to his doings. He will recompense him. He took his brother by the heel in the womb, and by his strength he had power with God. Yea, he had power over the angel and prevailed. He wept and made supplication unto him, and found him in Bethel. And there he spake with us, even the Lord God of hosts. The Lord is his memorial. This is God remembering the goodness of Israel, how Israel developed through Jacob, and the power that she had. But yet God is aware of all the little controversies that he has, even with the people that follow him. Does God have a controversy with you? Does he have a controversy with me? Are there still things, like when he speaks to the seven churches, we did this recently in Revelation, where he says, I love you for the things you're doing, but I have this against you and that against you. We need to have a time now when God doesn't have controversies against us. So we need to start looking inside ourselves at the little things that are still not quite right, not quite there, where God needs to still speak into our lives. Bringing about that perfection daily, isn't it? Seeking that prize of the upward calling in Christ Jesus. Chapter 13 and verse 14, finishing up here. I will ransom them from the power of the grave. What a fantastic prophecy. This is the resurrection. I will redeem them from death. O death, I will be the plagues. O grave, I will be thy destruction. Repentance shall be hid from mine eyes. Resurrection of Israel again. Romans 11. Really clear. He says, it's almost as he's saying two things in one sentence here. I will ransom them from the grave, but I will also be thy destruction. Repentance shall be hid from mine eyes. God's ways are not our ways. He sees everything happening all at once. He sees those that are faithful and those that are unfaithful, all happening at the same time. And the last verse here in chapter 14, verse 4. And this is the whole intention of God. I will heal their backsliding. I will love them freely, for mine anger is turned away from him. The healing of the backsliding. That's God's intention. All the time that God is looking upon the sin of Israel, looking upon your sin and my sin, he knows the end from the beginning. And those of us that want to be faithful, he will keep us faithful. Even though we may at times drop our cross, we need to just get down and pick it up again. It's hard to bring forth the whole of Hosea in one go, of course, but I wasn't trying to really do that, but just really to point out that God may call you to something outrageous in the future. Who knows? He may call me to do something outrageous. And sometimes it's just to go and speak to somebody that you haven't spoken to before, to bring the truth to them. And that's a mighty challenge. We need to do it in God's spirit and in his power and in his strength. So it's a bit of a rainy day today, but every day is a new day, whether the sun shines or whether it's cloudy. And God has an intention for you and an intention for me. And we need to say, Lord, is there an area of my life still where perhaps I'm backsliding, falling away? It's always a hard thing sometimes to come back and to drop what we were doing. But God wants us to be faithful, and he doesn't want us destroyed for lack of knowledge. So I would say to you, become informed about what's going on around you and see God's work in it. See the prophecy of God's word and how he's talking to us in these days. I'll leave that with you. Have a blessed day, whether you're working or whatever you're doing.